center is Gabe Mukobi. Gabe Mukobi will join me as a fellow tree attending Stanford University in the fall. He will be studying computer science and music, a combined major. And his favorite, memory and magnets. This is pretty cool, is building the wonky stuff in my Principles of Technology class. I'm not sure why that was his favorite memory, but it was. So please join me in welcoming Gabe. Hi.
Hi. Thank you very much. Thanks, Mr. Moody, for introducing me. So I'm Gabe. Here's my project. Okay, we won't worry about that. Here's an ordinary little soccer ball. I got it from fourth grade. Don't worry about it. Do you guys in the middle catch? Respond. Okay, ready to catch? And now can you throw it back? Because that's mine. I need it back. So that was pretty fun, right? But can you tell me, how long was that ball in the air? How far did it travel horizontally? How fast was it going at its maximum? You can, right? But that would be really cool if you could. So I'll snap to do that, it's a little flashy. I interned at Portland State University, and my lab tried to answer those questions. Here's the kind of people I worked with. My main mentor was Dr. Ralph Weidenhorn, who actually Ms. Newman helped set me up with, so I think you've heard of the magnet program. But we were really trying to answer those questions about motion by using a newer technology and applying it to physics labs. That's really what we wanted to look at. So for issues such as like the projectile motion of a ball or a rocket or something, those are important questions to ask in physics, and for lots of education in the high school and the college level, students don't really get the best intuition as to what's really happening with data that's collected by hand or by video analysis. So what we did is we implemented this technology called POSIX. So POSIX is a localized positioning system. What that means is that it's basically a scaled down version of GPS, and with that we're able to collect lots of interesting data. So here's kind of some interesting pictures, I don't know, they just look cool, of GPS. How GPS works is that you basically have an array of satellites around the world, and those satellites communicate to each other and to your phone, and tell your phone where it is, with an accuracy of 10 meters and a data rate of 1 time per second. So that's pretty fine for driving and such. GPS can be anywhere from like 6 to 20 meters in its accuracy. So for driving, that's fine, but for the scaled-down versions of physics that we're looking at, that's just not acceptable. Like, if you wanted to see how far that ball's going to you, that's like, I don't know, 20 meters, 10 meters, something, that we can't have those accuracy ranges. So with POSIX, we get a scaled-down version of GPS that you can put in a classroom. And with this, it uses a newer technology, smaller scale, and increased, more fancy radio communications frequencies, with which it's able to communicate data at 100 times per second or more, with accuracies of 10 centimeters. So those accuracies are very good and really allow us to actually get the intuitions necessary for physics data. So what I did, I was the lead software designer, programmer guy. I designed all the software that interfaced with the hardware, the actual the chips that you saw on the previous slide. That interface with it, told it what data to collect, how we wanted to see that and represent it and interact with it, and also built. Here's an example of some data going by. Lots of the process was coding lots of stuff, as I just showed, debugging stuff, collecting lots of data and seeing how we could analyze that, and pushing data up. Here's something I'm kind of proud of. So we store our data on GitHub, which is like cloud for coders, I guess. But I'm proud to be the number one contributor to our repository, which means that I had 375 commits, which is when you like check in all your stuff, essentially like saving your progress because you've done something. And then of that, there are 997,000 additions, which are individual lines of code that I added. And 300,000 subtractions, which are stuff you took away. So there's lots of coding in this project, which is really good for me. Other presenters mentioned making mistakes, which is really important. Right there, there's 300,000 mistakes, at least. Actually, many more than that I still haven't found yet. But through making all those mistakes and being able to work through them and fix them, I really learned a lot in this project about programming that I'll take to the future, much more than just the scope of what this project was intended for at its outset. Another big thing I worked on was building a graphical user interface so that teachers and students likewise could really interface with this technology easily without using any prerequisite knowledge. So they wouldn't have to type in the fancy code to make stuff run, just click on big buttons, which is a lot easier. So with this, we really want to tailor this towards physics education. So we looked at all different kinds of kinematics, like 3D stuff, 1D stuff. There's also a bunch of motion sensors, like accelerometers and gyroscopes on each of the chips we worked with. So with that, we're able to just collect a whole slew of data with which to test different things. One example of this is a common physics experiment where if you slide a cart up and down the track, you can measure its acceleration due to gravity. So, ooh, fancy transition. So when we did this, the acceleration we measured was within 0.2% of the ground truth, which means it's definitely very accurate and viable for a classroom setting. We also apply that to lots of other stuff, so we can do motion of a rocket. This JIT load is kind of slow. Yeah, and it is JIT, not GIF. We can find motion of a rocket, and when we did that, we actually found that we had to account for different drag coefficients to find an accurate model of the motion, which for a student perspective, that really helps you come to grips with, oh, like real life isn't that clear. You actually have to account for these different things in order to get an accurate representation, which you don't really get by hand stopwatches and traditional methods. So really, the applications are pretty limitless. Something else we're doing is we're in contact with the Portland Trailblazer trainers, and they're interested in using this technology or a similar thing on their players during recovery. So, for example, you can measure the accelerations and movements of players, how fast they're turning around, how far they run over a given period of time, to make sure they're not pushing themselves too hard during recovery, but they're still getting the good workouts that they need. That's pretty much it. Really, what we're looking at forward to this is fixing more of those bugs. That's really my job with that code, making it easier to run and more applicable to physics. Not only are we trying to apply this to new physics problems and data sets to collect, but also trying to design new physics experiments with which to leverage the full potential of this technology, since it really provides such more accurate and in-depth data of what's really happening in the 3D space than traditional methods. So thank you, I'm Gabe Akobi. There you go, thank you.